Hey guys, this is Black Cat Saloon. Did you ever have an experience as a child, or perhaps a teenager, that helped define and shape who you are? You know, one of those experiences that just kind of sticks with you, a vivid memory, an ingrained memory, as if it had just happened yesterday. Well, I'm going to share with you an experience I had as a young teenager, and it'll make sense by the end of the video what it has to do with these two blankets here. But what got me thinking about this experience was when I had purchased initially this blanket and then later this blanket. It got me thinking about this experience that I had as a teenager, and I thought it might be a useful story to tell. I was 13 years old, and it was pretty much toward the end of summer, August, and that was when our town had the homecoming festival. And it was like any other homecoming festival event. You know, there was music, street vendors, and a carnival. And it was the festival's last night, nearing the close, and folks were already emptying out. And my cousin, who was a year older than me, had heard that they were hiring teenage boys to help with the teardown. So we had, milled about and asked about, and we talked to one carny, and he pointed over to where the trailers were parked, and he said, "You got to go talk to the man." So we headed over that way, and there was a large trailer over there, and there were probably a dozen or so teenage boys all gathered around. You know, most were about our age, and they looked to be 14 or 15 years old, and they were talking, and just. Everybody was wondering what kind of work we'd do or if they'd get hired. And then the trailer door opened and the man walked out. And all the boys, instantly became quiet. The man was large. He was this great big huge guy. And he was pretty much plain clothes, except I remember that he was, he had like a really like a brightly colored, it looked like probably like a silk handkerchief that was peeking out of one of his shirt pockets. And then he said, "All right, listen up, guys. We need to hire some backyard boys to help with the teardown." And he pulled out this great big, large roll of cash. And he's holding it in one hand, and he holds it up high over his head. And then the man says, "I'll pay $20 for each ride you help tear down." And you could hear, a gasp in the crowd, all the teenage boys, $20 per ride, My cousin and I were looking at each other and then back toward the midway, it's thick and surrounded by rides. So we're thinking, we're going to make $200 or $300 tonight, easy. So we stood there in front of the man, our eyes all big and wide like saucers, And the man started pointing at boys and sending them off to different rides to help with the teardown. And then he pointed at my cousin and me. And he said, "You two, head over to the Chump Twister." And we really didn't know what the guy was talking about. We're looking and we're thinking, does he mean the Scrambler? Does he mean the Tilt-A-Whirl? So we start heading over that way. And then he yells at us again, no, over to the carousel, over to the carousel. So we started, running toward the carousel. We took off like a light. And we're, as we're running, we're, whispering to each other, the Chump Twister, the Chump Twister. We're chanting like a mantra almost, as if the man had imparted some type of, secret knowledge to us, And we thought, we were eating this stuff up just like typical teenagers would. So we get, we run over to the carousel with the carnival folk, apparently. Later we learned, that's what they call the Chump Twister. And we get there and we're all out of breath and stuff, and we go up to the operator and we say, the man sent us over here to help with the teardown. So the guy, the operator, looks at us and he says, I remember his words exactly, "You can call me Pappy and this here's Pop." And he pointed over to this other carny, and apparently, that was Pop. That was his name. And Pop didn't talk much, although Pappy, he pretty much talked the whole night. And these were old school carnies. I remember seeing, in the back of the trailer where they put the carousel, and they traveled, in between the carnivals. And there were like a couple of old mattresses in there. They had like an old lantern in there. So these two guys actually lived in the back of the trailer that housed like the carousel once they took it apart. And these rides, I mean, this was like an old-time, old-school carnival, and they weren't like the like some of the new rides you see today where they all kind of fold up automatically and they go right into the back of a semi. These things had to be taken down piece by piece, nut by nut, you know, bolt by bolt, and you basically had to tear the whole thing down by hand. You know, so that's what we did, and we started working on it and helping out with tearing down the carousel. And it was probably, you know, 3 o'clock in the morning before it became apparent to both my cousin and I that, you know, this ride, we're sticking with this ride all night long because it's going to take all night to tear down this one ride. And by then we had already invested so much time in it, we stuck it out, you know. And come the crack of dawn, and it took literally all night long to tear down that single ride. We stayed with that ride all night long. The crack of dawn, we were finishing up, and the man was coming around. He was paying all the teenagers that were still there, all the boys that helped out. And, you know, he came up and handed me my $20, handed my cousin, you know, he got his $20, and he handed me my $20. And I tell you what, you know, that when the man handed me that 20 bucks, guys, you know, it felt like $1 million. It could have been $1 million. So I learned a really valuable lesson that night, and probably the most important lesson was that I learned the value of a dollar. You know, and 20 bucks is to this day, to me, 20 bucks is still 20 bucks. Okay, and that's kind of the story, and that gets back to, and I'm gonna, there's a lot of little life lessons in that story, but back to the blankets here and how this ties in with these two with these two blankets. Okay, this is the first blanket I purchased here. You know, I like tinkering. I usually tinker around with my bug out bag, and I wanted to add a bedroll, you know, I remembered back from when I was in the military, the wool blankets, they were very, very durable, and I remember them being pretty lightweight, so I thought it'd make an excellent bedroll, you know, an excellent addition to my bug out bag. So I, unfortunately, you know, I don't have a military surplus store nearby, so I had to kind of look online. And I looked around, you know, Amazon.com, eBay, and that kind of stuff. And this blanket here seemed to fit the bill, you know, by the description. You know, it was sold, slated, you know, kind of they sold this as a military surplus blanket. Guys, this blanket isn't fit to use in your home. This is the worst blanket I have ever seen in my entire life. You know, one of the first things I noticed when I got this blanket was just the material. It did not seem woven. It seemed more like it was fused. And right, you know, what popped into my mind was a chicken McNugget. You know, it kind of reminded me, you know, of a chicken McNugget, how it's supposed to be chicken. I mean, it's something. It's fused together. It's sold as chicken, but really, you know, you're not quite sure if it's really chicken or really what's in there. You know, I felt the same way about this blanket. It became, to me, you know, the chicken McNugget blanket right here. And when you look at it, when you hold this blanket up to the light, it doesn't look woven. It looks fused, you know, just like a chicken McNugget. So, one of the things that when I looked at the tag, and I'm going to put both the tags from both of these blankets exactly what it said on the tags, so then you guys can look at it and hopefully not make the same mistake I did. But this blanket was sold as 70% wool and 30% synthetic. So the first thing I'm going to tell you guys is stay away from anything that has synthetic in it. Just go with 100% wool, even if it's like this one here is 65%. Virgin wool, 35% reprocessed wool, but that's okay. It's still 100% wool. But I'll put what's on the tags down in the information box below so you guys can see that and read that for yourself. So if you're out looking for a blanket, hopefully you won't waste your 20 bucks like I did. But one of the first things I noticed on this tag, and right away I knew I was in trouble, is it said dry clean. You know, what kind of freaking blanket that you put the U.S. stamp on and try to sell it as a military blanket, would you dry clean? And I think it said delicate wash or something. You could wash it, but it had to be delicate cycle. But anything that says on the tag, delicate or dry clean, stay away from. Now, and this kind of ties into the story too. You know, did in the article the about the or the page that was selling this, the, I can't remember if it's eBay or Amazon or whatever. You know, did it tell me that it was dry clean only or delicate wash? No, it didn't. So they withheld, to me, a key piece of information. It's kind of the same thing that the man did for my story. You know, he held up a large roll of bills and said, you know, $20 per ride. But what he failed to tell us is that it takes all night to tear down one ride. So he left out some important information there. So it's just something to think about. Always ask questions. If you're looking for a blanket, that would make you a good filled blanket, like a bedroll, ask a lot of questions about it. So let's get to this blanket that I did find. This is about the texture and feel and weight and everything of how I remember the military blankets being when I was in the military. I think this blanket will hold up exceptionally well. It's a woven blanket. You know, I'm happy with it, but I had to, unfortunately, go through this experience of basically getting taken. And guys, let me tell you, I threw this thing in the wash, this one here, and I literally, the McChicken, or the McNugget blanket, you know, I literally got a basketball, right out of the washer when I pulled it out, like a basketball-sized wad of whatever this stuff's made out of that came right out of the washer. And then I put it in the dryer to dry it, and literally there was so much stuff coming off of this. Whatever this thing's made of, I'm not even convinced it's got any wool in it at all. I don't know. But this thing is just unfitting for home use. It actually plugged up my dryer vent. I had to clean it out. That's how much debris was coming off this. The only thing I can see this blanket potentially being used for would be like an emergency, a relief situation where they're passing these out, and it's basically almost like a disposable blanket. You know, any blanket you can't wash, if you can't throw it in the washer and just wash it, you don't want it. You certainly don't want it as a filled blanket. This blanket I threw it, you know, right in the wash, didn't have a problem with it. You know, got a little bit of lint off, but that's you're gonna get that with any blanket at all. Okay guys, another thing I want to point out is that you can track down military gear based on what's called an NSN number or a NATO stock number. If you can get a hold of one of those, and that's good to plug that number right in the search box if you're out on Amazon.com or eBay or whatever. That'll help you track it down. I guess, in summary, guys, if you're looking for a good fill blanket, go with 100% wool. If anything says that it has synthetic material in it or dry clean or delicate wash, stay away from it. If they don't list it, because again, when I looked at this blanket, it looked like you look at the picture and you look at the description, it was kind of looking like a general run-of-the-mill military surplus blanket. So I would, if they don't put on there, if you don't see any washing instructions, ask the question. Ask them to let you know what the tag actually says. So that's it, guys. You know, in summary, the experience I had that night, I wouldn't trade it for the world. It really helped me understand the value of a dollar. To this day, you know, $20 to me is still $20, and I hate waste. I don't like wasting money. You know, there are a lot of good lessons in that little story there, and one of which is exactly what the man did. You know, the man was a showman. You know, he was like a good salesman. You know, he would have made an excellent politician. You know, he held up a big wad of money, you know, and said, you know, $20 per ride. You know, without telling us that it takes all night to tear down one ride. You know, and that's kind of too what you see politicians doing. You know, they kind of are telling us what they think we want to hear. And, you know, most of the time when you listen to politicians, they generally, I'm not saying they're lying, but they certainly withhold the truth. But in their defense, guys, you know, I'm not sure really that our nation or Americans, you know, have the moxie for the truth. You know, our government's spending trillions of dollars right now, and that we're putting that burden on our children and our grandchildren, and it's you know, nobody wants to really discuss that or talk about it. So that the whole political side there is, we'll leave that for a different video. But that's it, guys. I hope you enjoyed the story. I hope you found this video useful. And if you want a good field blanket, again, look for 100% wool. That's it, guys. Talk to you next time, and take care.